'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus and to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise and to know, thus saith the Lord, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
I'm so glad I've learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that thou art with me, will be with me to the end.
Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me is falling, but he bids me go through the voice of hope. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power?
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Are you fully trusting in his grace this hour?
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Are you washed?
Are you washed
in the blood?
In the blood,
in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed?
Are you washed
in the blood?
In the blood,
in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by,
take it
standing on the promises of Christ my King. Through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of Christ my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Through death into life everlasting, he passed and we follow him there. Over us sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. His word shall not fail you, he promised. Believe him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, his perfect salvation to tell. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the thing. Thank you.
Good evening to everyone, and welcome to our worship tonight. We trust that you will be encouraged and built up in your faith as we hear God's word and meditate upon it and bring to him our praise and worship. I don't think I need to underline anything on the bulletin by way of announcements for the folks here this evening. So we lift our hearts and voices and worship God as we sing, "Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land." Let us join together in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we come to worship you this evening as our great God, who is our Redeemer and our Sovereign and our Lord, who guides and directs us through the difficulties that we face in life. We thank you, Lord, that each morning we get up, whatever trials and tribulations that may face us, we can begin the day in prayer and put our trust in you and know that you will guide us and direct us. We thank you, Lord, that you have a plan and purpose for each one of our lives. And we thank you, Lord, that we can put our trust in you and have confidence in you and bring to you each care and concern. We thank you that Jesus is our great high priest, who is seated at God's right hand, there forever to intercede for us. And so, Lord, we come now this evening and we pray that you will be our guide and that you will lead and direct us. Lord, we confess that sometimes you lead us and we rebel and we wander away from the path. Sometimes we end up in a right mess. And yet, Lord, when we cry out to you again, you are gracious and merciful, ready to forgive us and to redirect us and to bring us back out of bypath meadow and out of the valley of gloom and the dark places. And we thank you, Lord, that you bring us back and you delight when we turn again to you, and you are ready to redeem us, to forgive us, and to put us back on the path to the heavenly kingdom. Lord, we ask now that you will come and speak through your word, and that its truth will come to us with a freshness and with an insight that perhaps will be new to some of us as we read this passage in the book of Numbers. That its truth, Lord, might shine into our hearts, and that as we understand it a little better, we will be built up and encouraged and pointed to the Lord Jesus, who continues to exercise this great high priestly ministry. Moses and Aaron stumbled and fell, but our Savior Jesus will not. And so, Lord, rather than think poorly of Aaron or Moses as we read the story, may our hearts be inclined to focus upon Jesus and to go from this service encouraged and strengthened, knowing that he will not falter or he will not fail. So, Lord, thank you for this time. Encourage and build us all up, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. And we read from the book of Numbers. June is our reader this evening, and we're going to read a story from Numbers chapter 20.
Just sharing something with you before I start. Just as I was about to put on my reading glasses, I'm trusting in the Lord because they broke in two, David. Reading Numbers 20, verses 1 to 13. Water from the rock. In the first month, the whole Israelite community arrived at the desert of Zin, and they stayed at Kadesh. There Miriam died and was buried. Now there was no water for the community, and the people gathered in opposition to Moses and Aaron. They quarreled with Moses and said, "If only we had died when our brothers fell dead before the Lord. Why did you bring the Lord's community into this wilderness that we and our livestock should die here? Why did you bring us up out of Egypt to this terrible place? It has no grain or figs, grapevines or pomegranates, and there is no water to drink." Moses and Aaron went from the assembly to the entrance of the tent of the meeting and fell face down, and the glory of the Lord appeared to them. The Lord said to Moses, "Take the staff, and you and your brother Aaron gather the assembly together. Speak to that rock before their eyes, and it will pour out its water. You will bring water out of the rock for the community, so they and their livestock can drink." So Moses took the staff from the Lord's presence, just as he had commanded him. He and Aaron gathered the assembly together in front of the rock, and Moses said to them, "Listen, you rebels, must we bring you water out of this rock?" Then Moses raised his arm and struck the rock twice with his staff. Water gushed out, and the community and their livestock drank. But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, "Because you did not trust in me enough to honor me as a holy in the sight of the Israelites, you will not bring this community into the land I have given you." These were the waters of Meribah, where the Israelites quarreled with the Lord, and where he proved holy among them. And the Lord add his blessing to this reading.
Thank you very much, June. I noticed when you print it out in a big enough font, you can still read it without your glasses. So that's a trick now for others who are readers of you. Print the font big enough, you can always manage. We join together in our prayers as we pray for others. And I mentioned this morning a conference that I went to yesterday, organized by First Things, a group within the Church of Ireland. And I was impressed by quite a number of things at it. One of the things somebody I was sitting beside commented to me on was that not just the number of people were there, the place was packed out. And they had to pay to go to it as well. I got a free ticket because the bishop invited me, but it wasn't expensive, but the folks were keen to come. But the comment that this lady made to me was not just the number that were there, but the number of young people. Now, to be fair, there were a lot of older people as well, But there were a significant number of people a lot younger than me. There weren't many teenagers, I don't think there were people, but people in their 20s and 30s and their 40s. So that was an encouragement to her, I think an encouragement to all of us, to think that there are keen young evangelicals who are involved in the Church of Ireland. I am assuming that most of them were Anglicans, apart from a few visitors like myself. That prompts me to pray for them, and to pray for our own church, and indeed for the other churches in the village here, for the younger generation. I'm just kind of looking around this evening, and we tend to have more of the young people in the morning, and apart from the team at the back, there aren't all that many of you who look like you're a lot younger than me, and some of you look like you're a year or two older, and that's okay. But let's pray that God would raise up a generation of younger people committed to the work of the gospel and to the Lord's work in this church, in the churches in the village, and indeed throughout the land. I think it is probably true that younger folks tend to be once-ers. You know what I mean by a once-er? Somebody who comes once to church on a Sunday. I love people who are twicers, who come morning and evening. And it was interesting. I was reading in another Christian newspaper that I get during the week, a monthly thing, and there was a comment about Rico Tice. He'd given an interview to Evangelicals Now, explaining why he had effectively left the Church of England and was worshiping with his family in an international Presbyterian church in London, near where the school his kids go to. And he commented about how he and his children went to church to this place twice on a Sunday, morning and evening. And there's a blessing. I have to say, when I was a youngster in my late teens, went to university, I could only go to church once at home because we only had one service, apart from the very occasional evening event or district event. But when I went to university as a 19-year-old, I had a whole choice of churches to go to in Belfast. I very rarely went home at the weekend. Most weekends I stayed in Belfast. And I went to church morning and evening. Now, in the evening, I went to a variety of different churches. I didn't always go to the same one. In fact, in the morning, I sometimes went to different ones. And then eventually got settled into Donegal Road Methodist, which was my spiritual home, and where Nikki and I went when we got married a few years later. And we went morning and evening. And it's a blessing to be here. So let's pray for a younger generation of people who will grow and be committed to the work of the gospel, and committed to their church, whether this church or other churches, morning and evening. And then a couple of little pointers from our prayer focus to pray for Bangor and Hollywood and Finnichy and Seymour Hill, and for the Methodist Church in Zimbabwe. And we'll pray for those things, as well as a little quiet time when we can bring our own concerns for folks, family and friends we know who are sick and in particular need of prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for our church family. And we thank you, Lord, for all the different age groups who come. Now, in the evening, perhaps they are the older ones who come. Will you bless the youth fellowship who will come this evening later on to meet in the manse? And though there are only maybe 6 or 8 or 10, 11 of them, we thank you for them. And we pray that you will continue to do works of spiritual significance in their lives. That they will grow and mature in their Christian faith. We pray, Lord, for those who are kind of the next age group up, who are in their 20s and 30s, some of them married or getting married, some with young families. Lord, we pray that you will help them to prioritize rightly in their lives. With all the pressures of work and sometimes both partners having to work and pay the mortgage and so on, and then when young children come along, there's an extra pressure upon them and on their time and so on. But we pray that they will focus their priorities upon you and upon their involvement and commitment to service within the church. Thank you, Lord, that many of those people in our church are committed and are involved in Boys Brigade and Girls Brigade and Youth Club and come in the morning and bring their children and are part of our church family. Lord, will you prosper them and bless them spiritually, as well as in every other way within their homes and in their families and in their work. We thank you, Lord, for young people involved in other churches. We pray for those young people that were there at that conference yesterday from the Church of Ireland. We pray too, Lord, for the Presbyterian churches, for the Elam, and for the other churches in and around this district. And we ask for the younger generations within them, that they will give committed service and be encouragement to those of us who are getting long in the tooth and old and gray. We thank you, Lord, for faithful older people who can continue to mentor and to encourage and to pray for the younger generation. We thank you, Lord, especially for an older generation of faithful praying people who may themselves not even be able to come to church at all, once, never mind twice on a Sunday, but who still pray for the church and for the children and the teenagers and the young adults who will be the significant leaders of the next generation. We pray too, Lord, for for our Methodist church throughout Ireland, and we pray for the Hollywood, Bangor and Hollywood circuit. Pray for the ministers there, for Philip Corrigan and for Sharon Connor. We pray for the circuit in Finnickey and Seymour Hill, though that Seymour Hill church is closed just fairly recently. But we pray for Colin Gracie and for others who help, for Matty McCrae, the youth worker, and for B. Maxwell, who does pastoral work in Finnickey. Will you bless and encourage those circuits? In times past, they were strong. We thank you, Lord, the church in Finnickey is still reasonably strong. And in Bangor, we thank you, Lord, that that there is still a strong congregation. The name of it's escaped me, but you know the one I'm thinking about, Lord. And others have closed, and some are not just as strong. But we pray that you will build up your church in these places, and that the younger generation in them will contribute significantly to the life of those churches in the decades to come. We pray too, Lord, for the Methodist Church in Zimbabwe, and we thank you for it, and for those who come to us from Zimbabwe, and we thank you for the links that we have in various ways. And we know that that nation, that country, is going through continued cycles of political turmoil and discomfort. We ask, Lord, that there might be some measure of stability, and we pray that you'll bless the church, not just the Methodist Church, but all the Christian denominations in Zimbabwe, that they will have a good influence upon the nation, and that there will be spiritual growth, and that there will be peace and stability and a growing prosperity for the people who've gone through, since Mugabe's day, some difficult times and continue to do so. And then, Lord, finally, we just take a quiet moment to remember some of our own circle of family and friends and neighbors. Thank you, Lord, for some good news about some who are making progress. We thank you, Lord, for news of one who has committed his life to Christ in recent weeks, still facing uncertainty with regards to his health. We pray, Lord, for those who are in hospital, those who are going to go into hospital in a week or two's time to have surgery, for those, Lord, who are going through treatment for cancer, both in our own church and others in the village. And we know that there are quite a number of such people. We ask, Lord, that you'll bless the medics who are caring for them. We pray, Lord, for those who are providing pastoral care in various ways. And we pray especially for family and friends and neighbors. So in the quiet moment now, Lord, we bring to you in prayer some of those who we are thinking about. So, Lord, will you graciously hear and answer all our prayers? For we ask them in Jesus' name. Amen. And now we bring our offering to God for his work. We'll sing together again at Rock of Ages, Cleft for Me. Now, those of you who come on a Wednesday afternoon or evening will know that I promised to share a few thoughts on this interesting story in chapter 20 that puzzles some, or certain aspects of it at least, and puzzle people. I trust that as we meditate upon it this evening, that you will get one or two clues to perhaps the answers to some of those puzzlements. But more than that, that you will be greatly blessed and encouraged as believers. because this story contains within it something that is really wonderful and helpful, I think. It would do us good just to pause for a moment and go back a little bit into chapter 6, where we had this remarkable prayer that God gave to Moses for Aaron to pronounce upon the people. We call it the priestly blessing or the Aaronic blessing. And we preached on it a few Sundays ago, and we sang it at the conclusion of the service. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. The children of Israel were going to be going on a long, arduous journey. It turned out to be longer than it needed to be, but nonetheless, it was going to be some 40 years that they would wander through the wilderness before eventually they would come into their inheritance in the promised land. You and I are on a long, sometimes arduous journey until we too will reach our inheritance that is kept for us in heaven. Our inheritance, says Peter, will not fade or spoil. It's reserved for us. We know it's there, and one day we will enter into it. But before we get there, there may be many mountains to climb, rivers to cross, wildernesses to trudge through. We will need to know on that journey the blessing of God. We will need to know that God is on our side, that he is with us, that he will never leave us nor forsake us. For if Satan can get us doubting the love of God and ceasing to believe in his grace and in his rich blessing, then Satan will have won a significant victory. For if God doesn't really love me today, then he never has loved me, and he never will. For God does not change. And if God doesn't love me, perhaps it wouldn't be a wise thing for me to go to heaven, to live too near Almighty God, not being confident of his love for me. For in a sense, that would turn heaven itself into a kind of hell. It's a big thing to know that God is for you and he's here to bless you. And of course, the role of the high priest was to bless and to encourage the people. That was Aaron's chief task. Now, he had lots of other jobs and sacrifices to do and stuff, but his chief role was to represent God to the people as the high priest. He was the mediator between God and the people. Of course, it's a picture of something even more wonderful for us as Christians, because Jesus is our great high priest. He's seated at God's right hand from where he intercedes for us. Given that context, we can now see the point of this rebellion in chapter 20. For it was the very priest who should have made the people conscious of the blessings of God that rebelled against God himself. It was Moses, the lawgiver, who rebelled against God, with the result that neither Moses nor Aaron would eventually be allowed to enter into the promised land. We'll say more about that in a moment. You might be thinking, well, that must have been a very serious thing. Perhaps it's difficult at first sight to think why it was so serious when all Moses did was whack this rock a couple of times instead of speaking to it. Well, if you want to know how serious it was, well, look up various places in the Bible where it's mentioned. It's mentioned three times in the book of Numbers, and then six times in the book of Deuteronomy. Now, in our reading through this, we're not starting into Deuteronomy yet. So there's a little, I'm not going to tell you where they all are. You can look them up yourself. But as you're going through Deuteronomy, next week when I'm away in America, or the week after, two 3 weeks, actually, we'll have to read Deuteronomy. Just make a wee mark, note those occasions, and see if you can find all six of them where that is referenced. I'll give you a clue. I'll give you at least one of them later on, but it was a significant thing. We'll see now why it was so. Now, it's very similar to a story in Exodus chapter 17, which I preached on. In fact, I preached on it more than once from this pulpit. Maybe the first time, actually, it might have been from the back of a lorry in the car park. I can't quite remember when it was the first time I referenced that story. It's an amazing story of Israel coming out of Egypt, and very shortly after they had been delivered, there was dreadful rebellion. The people were for turning back. They were for stoning Moses. And God said, right, we're going to have a to-do here. We'll settle this issue. And he told Moses to take the rod with which he had struck the Nile, turned it into blood. It was an implement of the judgment of God. And God told Moses to gather all the people in front of this rock. The elders were to be at the front. And Moses was to take this rod with which he had struck the Nile. And, well, I needn't spin the story out because you know it. The rod that should have fallen upon the backs of those rebellious and wicked people with their elders at the front of them, leading the people astray, in fact, came down upon the rock upon which God stood. There's an old hymn. Interestingly, I looked this up because it's in Redemption Hymnal, but this verse isn't in it. if you look up the original online, you'll find about six or eight verses. And there's this line that says, Jehovah lifted up his rod. O Christ, it fell on thee. Thou wast sore stricken of thy God, and not one stroke for me. Christ bore the judgment of God's wrath. And that demonstration to those wicked, rebellious children of Israel who had just been delivered out of Egypt still rings in our ears now. Because there was a greater day when God himself came down upon the rock and Christ bore the judgment of God upon himself as he died upon the cross. As Romans 8 says, he who did not spare his own son, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? In the midst of our difficult journeys, we have this as our greatest resource, that God is for us. And he demonstrated it by the giving of his son, the Lord Jesus. Well, that incident in Exodus 17 was some 40-odd years before this one. They are not two tellings of the same story. There are similarities in one sense, because the people grumbled against the Lord and against Moses, and Moses was told to take a staff and speak to the rock and water would come out. But it's important to see how different the two stories are. Yes, of course, the people ran out of water. That was similar. It said they quarreled against the Lord, and they certainly quarreled against Moses. Why have you brought us up into this place? Why are we coming out of Egypt in order to get the promised land? Why did it involve being brought through such a difficult place as this? This is just sheer thirsty desert. And it's getting more than we can bear, they said. And they did quarrel with the Lord. But it's not said that they tempted him, nor that they talked about stoning Moses. You see, these people were at the end of their tether. They were tired. They were discouraged. They were hungry. They were thirsty. Now, I'm not here to investigate you, but I wonder, have you ever in your heart quarreled with God? Have you ever been at the end of your tether, discouraged, hungry and thirsty and tired and weak, and you think that God hasn't heard your prayer or hasn't answered it the way that you think he should have answered it? And you're feeling a bit discouraged and maybe you're cross with God. Oh, no, you wouldn't maybe say it out loud. Well, maybe you would. I don't know. But if you've never felt that way, some of you have been on the journey as long, if not longer, than me, so I'd be surprised if you've never faced that kind of circumstance. What was God's answer? How will God deal with the people this time? Well, first of all, he is not going to treat them as rebels. He's going to treat them with great compassion. And he tells Moses to take the staff. Now, pause for a moment. Which staff are we talking about? Is it the staff that was mentioned in Exodus chapter 17? The staff of judgment with which he struck the Nile? Or is it the staff that gets a prominent, albeit very short, little chapter in Numbers chapter 17? Two 17s, easy to remember. Exodus 17 and Numbers 17. In Numbers 17, we have the story about Aaron's rod. There was that dispute whether Aaron and Moses were really appointed by God and whether they had usurped the place. And a part of the story was that God told Moses to lay up the 12 staves of the 12 leaders of the tribes. And the tribe, the one representing the tribe of Levi, it wasn't the head of the tribe of Levi that was mentioned, but it was Aaron. And Aaron was to write his name on the staff. So they all knew who their staffs, which was their staff. Whether they all had their names on it or not, but Aaron was told to write his name on it. And in the morning, they were laid up in the tent of meeting before the Lord. And in the morning when they came in, 11 of the staffs were still just dead sticks. But Aaron's rod had budded, blossomed, with almonds, all the stages of life. It was that staff. If you read the story carefully in chapter 20, we are told, take the staff with you and your brother and go. And they took the staff from before the Lord. This was Aaron's rod. There was a symbol of his high priestly ministry as the intercessor who pleaded on behalf of the people. And they were told to take this and go to the rock and speak to it. In other words, to pray. That's what intercessors do, isn't it? They pray. And Moses and Aaron were to intercede on the part of the people and to pray for them. Not to strike the rock. That lesson had already been learnt. It's a different lesson from Exodus 17. For now God was going to give them a demonstration of his infinite compassion and care for his people. But instead of which, Moses and Aaron lost their tempers, got exasperated. Hear what Moses says in verse 10. Hear now, you rebels! What? Moses is accusing the people of being rebellious. It's Moses and Aaron who are the rebels in this story and not doing what God told them to do. They hadn't got the discernment of the high priest to see that it wasn't rebellion, but that these people were at the end of their tether because of the trial that had come upon them. They couldn't read the hearts of the people the way that God could. It was as if this was another intolerable burden for Moses and Aaron to bear, even though they hadn't got much to do. Just pick up the staff and go and speak to the rock. Now, it's true that Moses and Aaron sometimes did have a difficult task, both of them, Moses in particular. Not this time, though. And Moses, losing his temper, took the staff of intercession and he belabored the rock twice. It was serious because in 1 Corinthians 10, you can read it sometime at your leisure, you'll see a number of references to these stories in Numbers. remembering various incidents in the wilderness when God brought water from the rock. And Paul said that Israel drank from that spiritual rock that followed them, and that that rock was Christ. And here was Moses belaboring the rock. Friends, if you remember only one thing from this sermon tonight, you do not have to belabor God. You do not have to beat God up and bully him and strike him and twist his arm to have him listen to your prayers and force him to bless you. Moses just had to speak. What a wonderful privilege it would have been to have been the mouthpiece on that occasion, to demonstrate to those tired, yes, grumbling, difficult people that God loved them and God saw their need. And Moses only had to ask, and the water would flow out. Now, of course, the water did come out anyway, because God was not going to cause the people to suffer further because of the failings of Moses and Aaron on that occasion. Though later in this very chapter, later in chapter 20, you can read about how Aaron was stripped of his role. He went up a mountain with his son Eleazar, and a ceremony was performed. His high priestly garments were taken off him, put on his son, and Aaron died. And then Moses too. Let me take you to a verse in Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 32 and verse 51. Maybe read verse 50 as well. There on the mountain that you have climbed, you will die, this is talking about Moses, and be gathered to your people, just as your brother Aaron died on Mount Hor and was gathered to his people. This is because both of you broke faith with me in the presence of the Israelites at the waters of Meribah Kadesh, because you did not uphold my holiness among the Israelites. This phrase, you did not uphold my holiness, you trespassed against me, you broke faith. It's a very powerful word that's used. It's a word that you might use for the unfaithfulness of a husband or a wife committing adultery. And so Moses was not allowed to go in, though he pleaded. Now he was given the opportunity to look in and to see the land from a distance, but he was not the one to bring the people into the promised land. Someone whose name was Yeshua, Jesus in English, was the one who would bring the people in. So God accuses Moses and Aaron of having trespassed against the Lord. And above all this, you didn't uphold me as holy in the eyes of the people. That's Numbers 20. You did not trust me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of Israel, and not bring this community into the land that I give. What does God mean? Well, if they had done what they were told to do and just spoken to the rock, then through their intercession, the water would have come out and the name of God would have been glorified. And the people would have said, marvelous! We began to doubt whether God really loved us or not. But look, there's water in response to prayer. Isn't this wonderful? And Moses and Aaron would have had the great delightful occupation of being the people who demonstrated that to the Israelites. Show them the wonderful character of God. The writer of the Hebrews picks this up. Hear what he says in Hebrews 7, verse 25. Therefore he is able, talking about Jesus, our great high priest, therefore he is able to save completely those who come to him through God. Come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for us. Such a high priest meets our need. one who is holy, blameless, pure, set apart from sinners, exalted above the heavens. And Hebrews 4, verse 14 to 16. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. So, what's this story all about? This final brief word of application. Not so much about Moses and Aaron, though there are lessons, no doubt, for us to learn from their disobedience and their rebellion and their failure. Not so much about that, but rather, this story is a glorious pointer to our great high priest, to the Lord Jesus, the one who will never fail, will never, in a moment of weakness and tiredness and frustration and temper, lose control like Moses and Aaron did. There are times when we are just like those people, at the end of our tether, hungry and tired and empty and prone to despair. And you cry out to God. What will God do? He's not going to bring down a rod of punishment upon our backs, but a staff of comfort and of compassion in the hands of our great high priest, who understands our weakness, sympathizes with us, empathizes with us, and he listens to our cries, and he is there to answer us. And when we are dry and thirsty, we'll pour out into our hearts and lives and souls that living water that bubbles up unto eternal life and makes the journey possible and gives us that reassurance that our great high priest is there to bless us, to guard us, and to guide us, and he will hold us fast. Let's sing that song. When I fear, my faith will fail.
Thank you.
And let's share the grace and bless one another. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.